afternoon. I have just turned on a standard electric light bulb, which has been unchanged except for the filament and the gas within the bulb since Edison patented it in 1880. Sam Taylor, what do you think the efficiency of this bulb is?
Pretty lousy.
Give me between 1 and 100%.
40%.
Melissa Marshall, what do you think the efficiency is between 1 and 100%?
30%.
30%. Well, actually, believe it or not, this light bulb, which we've used for so long and which is in everybody's home and workplace, is only 5% or less efficient. What this means is that we're spending about $55 billion a year on electricity, for which we use 20% of all the electricity generated in the United States and most other developed countries just for lighting. So if you're going to have something this inefficient, you've got to have a lot of energy. And 20% of our energy is being used for this. If you're going to have a lot of energy, you've got to have a lot of fuel. And in the United States, and most other places, in fact, most of our electricity is still generated by coal-fired power plants. The emission from these coal-fired power plants, in terms of CO2, is on the order of 110 million tons of CO2. An equivalent weight to our family automobile, the equivalent weight is 73 million automobiles. So if you line those automobiles up end to end, they would encircle the diameter of the Earth 9 times. You see on this map now the bright areas. The bright areas are where people are connected to a grid, like you and I. This is where we use that 20% of our electrical generating capacity for just lighting. But you'll see on that slide that the 1/3 of the population of the globe has no access to electricity. If you have no access to electricity, there's still light there. They still have to provide lighting in some way. So let's see how they do that. Candles, I'm very familiar with that. Diesel fuel, kerosene, whale oil, seal oil, particularly in the northern latitudes. Cheese, and my favorite, yak butter. All right, so, interestingly enough though, all of those sources spread throughout the world provide 1% of the global lighting, and yet they produce 20% of the CO2 in the atmosphere. That amounts to 210 million tons of CO2, which is equivalent to 93 million vehicles that, if you tied them end to end, would go to the moon and more than halfway back. The takeaway from this, takeaway number from this, is that 30% of CO2 put into the atmosphere throughout the world, 30% of the CO2 put in the atmosphere around the world is generated only for lighting. Do we have alternatives? Yes, we do. Interestingly enough, the legislatures of many of the developed countries have already pushed us into this passing laws bipartisanly, actually, that say, in the United States, after January 1, 2014, the 40-watt bulb, the 75-watt bulb, 60-watt bulb, and 100-watt bulb will no longer be for sale. You cannot, after inventories are depleted, you will not be able to go to your source of light of bulbs and buy them. They won't be there. I was in my Lowe's in Pittsburgh 2 weeks ago. Not a single incandescent light bulb was for sale. All right. So I think we can cut this one out. Other possible sources of light for us are the fluorescent light, the compact fluorescent introduced in 1995, and the light-emitting diode, which is here enveloped in a standard glass shell and also with an Edison end on it so you can screw it into your lamp. I have these up here. Let's take a look at some of the properties of these new sources which you're going to have to buy. First of all, efficiency. I'm going to emphasize the LED at this point because I think that the fluorescent light has pretty much reached the end of its innovation. The light-emitting diode has not reached the end of its innovation. It's still coming. It's still being made more efficient. Notice that it's 10 times more efficient in a unit which you're going to have to look at when you go to buy them. Lumens is the light output. Watt is the power input. They're going to give you both those numbers. You'll have to do the division to see how the efficiency is. So the efficiency of the LED is 10 times that of the Edison bulb. CO2 emissions, 10 times less for a 30 bulb equivalent than the incandescent light. But the fluorescent light, I'm not shutting that out. That is also quite an efficient light. But here's where the big difference is in lifespan. Notice that the incandescent light and the fluorescent light go up to about 1,000 hours and 10,000 hours respectively. But the LED starts about 50,000 hours. In fact, when you buy your house, you'll probably sell it before you change your light bulb. Okay? That's important because as we improve the lighting, as we improve the efficiency of the lighting, it also improves our visibility. What about the other areas, those black areas on the map? LEDs are also making their way into there. They're much simpler than what we're using. They're tied to solar cells. Notice on your right-hand side, they're tied to solar cells and storage facilities such as batteries or fuel cells, but they're able to provide light without tying to a source of electricity that is grid-wise. This is Kenya. This is Nepal, from where we saw some of the candles and other fuel oil being used, Nepal and Sri Lanka. Notice in the upper left-hand corner there, the LED or the LED set, they're providing light for kids to be able to study more and more and to go to further and further education in their schools. There's another source coming. This is called quantum dots. And you'll notice that the size up here is 5 nanometers in diameter. You're looking at the atoms of this thing. These things can be made either by changing their size or changing their composition to emit light at very sharp wavelengths. And I'll give you an example of this. I have vials here of quantum dots, and I can excite them all the way from the visible red through green to blue. And to give you an idea how small these things are, within each vial, there's 300 trillion quantum dots. All right. Now, they are already starting to enter your life. You see here, Sony, this is the reason you can have a ultra-high definition TV. They're now using quantum dots excited by other LEDs to produce these very pure reds, very pure greens, and very pure blues at very high resolution for your TV. And you'll notice the big guys are stepping in, other big guys are stepping in to start to adopt them as well. So quantum dots are going to be and are perhaps in your life very soon. Now these are optically activated. In other words, it took another light. This is photo-optically activated. This took another light to activate it. Can we use electricity to activate it? And that's still in the laboratory for these quantum dots. These are quantum dot light-emitting diodes. They're not yet very efficient, but the early LEDs weren't very efficient either. But these will be upwards of 80% efficient. These lights 80 to 85% efficient. This trumps the LEDs that we have now, which are 60 to 65% efficient. So in summary, this is both a timeline and a line of increasing efficiency, a line of decreasing amount of CO2, and the evolution of the ability to evolve to produce light in ever more efficient and less polluting ways is now happening. In fact, we've had more rapid change in lighting in the last 20 years than we had in the previous 100. Remember the takeaway? 30% of all CO2 in the atmosphere currently is produced, or globally, by lighting. Thank you.